If he only knew what adjectives had just been explained on his behalf. And then, moments later, my friend is once again his cool, calm, caring and collected self. That is, until the next unfortunate soul steers his car in the wrong direction and my friend once again unleashes a torrent of temper on the unsuspecting driver of the other vehicle. My own particular automotive stress builders were stoplights and slow-moving traffic. One day, while driving to my office, I found myself anxiously anticipating the change in every traffic light I encountered between my home and my office. Halfway there, I came to the astounding realization that I was doing my attitude and probably my health a great injustice. More than that, I realized that my behavior was not that which should be expected of a mature adult. I was dealing with traffic at about the same level that an 18-month-old child deals with hunger. I made an instant decision. I decided that never again would traffic in any situation cause me stress. I reinforced my decision with a few simple lines of situational self-talk. I enjoy relaxing while I am driving in the car. I always give myself the necessary amount of time to get anywhere I am going. I always arrive at or before the time I need to be there. Traffic lights change at their own discretion, not mine. If the light changes before I get there, I will stop, wait for the light to change and relax while I am waiting. Slow-moving or standing traffic is not a problem to me. I now enjoy the same time. I have to organize my thoughts and think about those things which are beneficial to me. I will get there when I get there. The self-suggestions took hold. A few times since then, on the way to an airport, a little behind schedule, I have had to consciously restate my self-talk. But since that day, I felt differently when I drive. Was it a difficult change to make? No. Could anyone else do the same? Yes. The chemicals of stress. What aggravation we give ourselves. What emotions we force ourselves to endure. Mind or brain researchers have gained great insight into the process of the effect of the natural chemicals our brains trigger and dump into our systems just from a minute or two of negative emotional stress. A few minutes of anger, anxiety, negative stress and frustration can literally toxify our physical systems for us. Why do we do it? Why do we let ourselves get out of control? We do it because we thought it was okay to be that way. We grew up not quite shaking off the last vestiges of immaturity. We kept a few of the negative behavior styles of our childhood with us so we could trot them back out when things don't go the way we'd like them to go. In businesses, I have seen some usually level-headed people, from the chairman of the board to the first-time secretary, momentarily throw their sanities out the window because life at that moment was not the way they wanted it to be. We are all very human, but there's nothing stopping us from stepping past a human frailty or two and rising above the crowd. If people around you choose to let situations and circumstances control them, there probably is not too much you can do about it. But you can do something about yourself. How you deal with every situation you confront, every unexpected jack-in-the-box complication, and every circumstance in your life which you cannot change or control. All of us have dozens of things we would like to change in our jobs, in our personal lives, at home, at school, with our friends, with the rules and laws we live by, with those who govern us, with how we spend our time, with everything about us. Conscious actions or uncontrolled reactions. But how do we react to those things in life which we can do nothing about will always be the truest test of our own self-control, our own individual sense of self and our ability to manage our minds and ourselves in a way that keeps us coming out on top and at peace with where we are. That is a part of maturity. That is taking responsibility for ourselves and living it every day. I am frequently amazed at the number of people who consistently complain about things they can do nothing about. How often we hear someone complain about something as totally uncontrollable as the weather. We have all known someone who let rain or an overcast sky ruin an entire day. The weather is exactly what it wants to do, the loudest complaint. Won't change it. Complaining about anything out of your control is not only senseless, but the negative self-talk we use to lodge the complaint has a direct effect on how we function that day, mentally and physically. It is so much easier and healthier to recognize the reality of the situation as it actually is, such as weather, and adjust our own self-talk to accept it and possibly even enjoy it. Why not? It's going to rain anyway. Try looking at it differently. Give yourself a few words of self-talk that will direct your subconscious and conscious minds to see things differently, at least for that day. It's raining today and that's fine with me. I'm going to have a good day and a little rain can't stop me. There's an increasing amount of medical and scientific evidence which tells us that something as simple as having a good attitude is much more than just a good idea. We have known for years that having a good frame of mind made things work better for us. But we now know that something as incidental as having the right frame of mind plays a part in a mental and biological chain reaction that involves every facet of what we are and who we are every moment throughout our entire lives. Research in the field of neuroscience suggests that such things as thoughts, moods, attitudes and actions play a far more important role in our mental and physical chemistry than we have ever thought possible. to us, the beneficiaries of this field of scientific research, the conclusions can be startling. How important are a few casual thoughts? They are more important than we have ever imagined. Our biological environment, our physical makeup and health affects our state of mind. The better condition our internal biological environment is in, the better we think and act. The reverse is also true. The more productively we think, the more positively we affect ourselves emotionally and physically. The situation cycle. Just the simple act of telling yourself you are going to have a good day, as an example, not only helps convince you mentally, it sets off chemical or electrical triggers in your brain, which affect your mental state, which in turn affects your psychologically, while in turn affects how you think. It's a self-generating cycle. Thought, emotional response, psychological response, thought, emotional response, and so on until something breaks or changes the cycle. This is why one negative incident first thing in the morning can cause a chain reaction which, if left unchecked, can affect everything else throughout the day. It affects our energy and our enthusiasm, our initiative and our spirit. The implication of this is that you can successfully scuttle an entire day by allowing even a single event to create the first step in a negative cycle. This negative cycle is not caused by the problem or event that appears to set it off. The cycle begins with how you respond to the problem in the first place. That is why it's just not practical physiologically or mentally to complain or get down about normal daily irritations or any of the things you can do about. But you can instead, within moments, change how you feel about them. Instead of creating a negative cycle, you can create a positive cycle anytime you choose. For most of us, creating positive cycles is a far more enjoyable way to make it through the day. Of course, we have all met those individuals who seem to enjoy being miserable. No matter how well things are going for them, they will find something to keep them feel unhappy. Fortunately, most of us like to feel good. You would rather be happy than unhappy. You would rather feel good than feel bad. And the truth is, anyone can feel happy or unhappy, in tune or out of control, almost anytime they want to. Your own internal self-talk is not a magic solution for every situation that comes up, but it can help you stay in control and deal with each of them more realistically and more effectively. We should not expect ourselves to have a smile on our faces every moment of the day, but I suspect that all of us would fare better at life by working at smiling a little more, maybe a lot more. Making the best of less than the best. There are times, however, when we are faced with situations which are quite normal, but which do not call for a countenance of eternal bliss. If you have ever taken a child into the emergency room at 11 o'clock at night and left an hour later with your child 16 stitches stronger and your bank account $250 poorer, you know what I mean. If that happened to you, imagine what would be going on in your mind. Even if the injury were not serious, you would be concerned. When the child came running in with the injury, whatever you were doing would have been immediately interrupted and you would probably spend the next hour or two sitting in the waiting area at the emergency room. It would not be the perfect ending to a beautiful day. If the situation happened to you, how would you feel? What unconscious thoughts would you say to yourself? More than likely, your emotions would be running somewhere between anger, concern, and being just plain upset. What you say to yourself at a time like that will affect the frame of mind you are in, how you feel, and how well you handle the situation and yourself. How well your son or daughter does will depend on the doctor and whatever words of encouragement you can offer. How well you do is entirely up to you. If you have made the decision to be in control of yourself, you will talk to yourself in the right way. Immediately, directly, realistically, and positively. Situational self-talk doesn't expect you to instantly change every bad situation into a good situation. It simply gives you a way to consciously put the best construction on any situation. It keeps you in control of yourself and allows you to function at your best under any circumstance that comes along. Have you ever been driving alone when you had a flat tire? I would wager that the self-talk that happens next is usually less than the best kind. If you have a spare and can change the tire yourself, you pull over, get out, open the trunk, wrestle the spare to the ground, find the jack and fight it out of its hiding place, jack up the car, force the hubcap from its locked-in position, physically and verbally fight the nuts off the wheel lugs, jockey the spare onto the hub, replace the nuts, pound the hubcap back into place, get back into the car and continue on your way. As you drive off, you do your best to rub the dirt smudges from your pants, dress or suit coat. By coincidence, you are not wearing your tire-changing clothes and then the incident happened. The self-talk that goes on from the moment you have the flat tire to sometime after, perhaps long after, either keeps us in control and keeps our spirits up, or as happens in most circumstances like this, our own words, our own thoughts make the problem worse. All too often, the words we have said to ourselves when things went wrong contributed to the problem, instead of making it better or helping us solve it. If you think about it, have you ever seen anyone whistling, humming a happy tune, or smiling while he was changing a flat tire on the side of the road? Endless opportunities to break or make your day. Things that get us upset can be anything and everything. Each day we are confronted with an obstacle, cause of endless possibilities of things which could upset us, make us angry, or drive us to distraction if we let them. The daily events that occur in the lives of even a few of us could give us an almost endless list of daily frustrations. The results of just one or two of them happening to you can create, with the wrong kind of self-talk, reason enough to get thrown, of course. The frustration is big enough, it can ruin the whole day. Situational self-talk may not change the problem, but if used consciously and immediately, the moment the need arises, it can rapidly change how you respond to the problem at hand and how you do for the rest of the day. Some of these situations are important, but some of them can be so petty that it's hard to see how they could upset us at all. What they all have in common is the way we react to them. They are the causes of arguments, frustrations, anxiety, stress and bad days, and they can be anything at all, large or small. The toast is burned, the plane is late, the boss is giving you a hard time, one of the kids came home with a bad report card, you're halfway through your shower and you run out of hot water, your favorite television program got preempted, you're late for work and you can't find anything to wear, your promotion didn't come through, etc, etc, etc. Are the things that go all wrong all that bad? To our subconscious mind, they are exactly as bad as we perceive them to be, as we tell ourselves that they are. Instead of getting needlessly upset and thereby starting a negative cycle, when you have to stand and wait in line, practice saying something different to yourself. Instead of thinking, "I hate standing in line," it is just as easy to use some self-talk to change how you look at standing in lines. If you wonder if it works, try it the next chance you get. "I don't mind standing in line. That's where I am and I am doing what I need to. Standing in line doesn't bother me and I really like getting things done." I know people who hate to get an answering machine message when they are trying to reach someone on the telephone. "I hate answering machines" is a program they have convinced themselves to believe. Actually, answering machines aren't all that bad. They help a lot of people stay in touch when they can't be by the phone. They make it possible for people to do something else without leaving the phone completely unattended. They serve their purpose. We can either decide to let them upset us, or we can recognize that they are a part of the technology of the century and decide to accept them, make them okay. The alternative is usually no one answering the phone. Telling yourself that you don't like to talk to a recorded message won't stop people from using them. It can't for the present be changed. What you can change is how you respond to them. "I'm glad I have the chance to leave a message." It is as it is. Whatever the example, it doesn't matter whether we are in the camp of those who like the way the situation is or not. If it is a situation that is, then it is. I know people who do not like to wear seatbelts when they are driving or riding in a car. They can be heard to proclaim every possible reason why they should not have to wear them. The reasons range from how seatbelts wrinkle their clothes or how uncomfortable they are, to saying that wearing them should be an individual choice, not a law. If wherever it is that you drive, you have to wear them, then you have the choice of wearing them or not. But you want to follow the rules, you have the choice of telling yourself what a nuisance you think they are or telling yourself that they don't bother you at all. They can be a daily grievance or they can be a nothing more than a safety device that is there, and there's no need to give it a second negative thought. Just as situational self-talk will work for the smallest of inconveniences, it will work equally well in more important circumstances, those as an example which directly affect our income and our professional growth. When I work with corporations and businesses, I hear grievances and resentments from individuals at every level of the corporate structure. Most of them are expressions of dissatisfaction with things that the individual can do nothing about. It may be company policy, government regulation, or a manager's actions, all of which are a part of normal business life. The positive self-talker soon learns to recognize the unchangeable realities of business. He only makes the best of them and stops fighting them consciously and unconsciously, but gets busy helping the company move ahead so he can have a good place to work and an opportunity to further his career. After spending many years in business environments, I could fill several chapters of a book discussing techniques and methods to overcome the obstacles of personal attitudes and applying self-talk to productivity in our jobs and careers. Just imagine what making minor daily attitude shifts could do for us on the job. I have never tried to estimate the number of major and minor problems and upsets the average individual faces in a month or a year. There's no need to dwell on them. We all have enough of our own. I've used just a few examples to give you the idea. I'm sure by now you have thought of your own examples. Think of anything in your day that gets in the way and you'll find an opportunity that could use some situational self-talk. There are even times when others around us will use any persuasive techniques possible to get us thinking in the right direction. I remember the story of the rather clever bride who dented the fender of her husband's new sports car. The car was his pride and joy, and she knew that the smallest nick in the paint would be a calamity to him. When she arrived home, she rushed into the house in hysterics. "I just had the most horrible accident and I wrecked your car." The husband, who was instantly concerned for his wife's safety, was greatly relieved when she assured him, through her tears, that she had come out of the wreck unscathed. Caught between his concern for his bride's well-being and agonizing over the loss of the car, the husband finally asked his wife where the car was now. "It's in the driveway," she said, still trying to calm herself down. The husband, worried and shaken, put his arm around his wife and together they walked out to the driveway to view the battered remains of his shiny new car. When he saw the small dent in the fender, his worst fears turned to joyous elation. "It's nothing at all. I'm glad you weren't hurt. We can get it fixed. Look, it's just a small dent. It's hardly even noticeable." If the wife had instead walked into the house and announced, "I just put a dent in your new car," I am sure the husband's reaction would have been a little different.